Okay, so happy to be with you. My name is Nicolas. Henchoz. I'm the founder of the EPFL EPFL+ECAL lab, so I'm coming from Switzerland. I see that we're 3 minutes late. Terrible. we're totally a time maniac in Switzerland. So basically, since for 10 years, I have been working on leading a lab looking at how we can turn technical performance into user experience. On our campus, we have about 2,000 PhD, 360 labs, but then it's always the question, what do you do with this technology? What do you do with this scientific performance? How we can re-bring something to the society? For sure, there's the knowledge, but then it's also the impact on the daily life. So I'm very happy to be with this consortium of Vertigo. I think it's a fantastic opportunity to see how art can bring, I mean, this another component to the innovation process and not rely only on technical performance. Just to give you something very simple, and I really like this analogy, you know, when we speak about technical performance, just think about the Concorde. At the time when you were able to leave Paris Charles de Gaulle at about 11 in the morning, and you were flying at 2.2 times the speed of sound, and so you were landing earlier in Manhattan at 9 in the morning. So you had the whole day. It was fantastic. Just sound effect performance, technical performance is real nice user experience. But what when you're flying back? You're landing at 4 in the morning at Roissy because you're flying very fast, or you have just a night of 3.5 hours, then everybody was taking, you know, first class to have a bed and fly slowly. So you have a strong sound effect performance, technical performance, but user experience is very poor. So it's a very simplistic example, but you see that was really affecting a project, and it was also affecting the people using this technology. So I think it's really great to have this opportunity, and now we'll also speak on this last panel about also the real-life impact. It was also the case before, but we had also some more theoretical parts. Here we'll work with or deal with the environmental issues, and I really like to work on this topic because it shows that data, ICT technology, it's not just algorithm for algorithm, code for codes, or data for virtual environment. It's really in our daily life, it's our environments, how the Earth is evolving from year to year. so we'll start with the first presentation, and here it's pollution explorers, so stay here, don't go out, it's very polluted. We have our artist Ling Tan. She will present both the scientific aspect and the artistic aspect, so thank you for coming. the project brings Hacker, it's a community setting technologies, and the social network to monitor pollution. And the other side, you have also an artist. She's looking also at social engagement. So there is a real connection. And it's about also Thessaloniki in London. So you see that it's a real European project. It's retaking the whole Europe under its umbrella. And it's a residency that is spread over 12 months. It started last November, and it will end up end of this November. So thank you for coming, Ling, and the floor is yours.
My name is Ling. I'm here to talk about Pollution Explorer. So before I go about talking about the project and the collaboration, I would just like to give a bit of introduction to who I am and the background to the project. So I'm an architect by training, and I'm also a designer, maker, and a coder. And the work that I do range within somewhere within the genre of social wearable technology, basically wearable technology that is not just about this passive sensing of collection of biometric data, but it's about how do you actually use wearable technology as a tool to empower people to collectively make decisions. And also, my work range also within the Internet of Things field, and also, most importantly, community engagement. I work a lot with different communities in different cities in using wearable tech as a tool to empower citizens to express about their relationship with the city, and most importantly, to figure out what is, with all the data collection, what can we do as a collective to tackle different issues. So Pollution Explorers is built on a 2 years initiative that we and Umbrellium have been doing. It basically answers a few questions that we have. First of all, can we sense the quality of air without the need for air quality sensors? Because often a lot of times with government, especially in UK itself, there's a lot of funding that's been pumped into installing air quality sensors in cities. especially in London itself, there's a lot of money that goes into it. The issue is that we already know the air is bad. We have enough data out there that shows us that the air is bad. What is the next step? What can we do then? So this project essentially invert that relationship and ask ourselves whether can we as citizens figure out ways to tackle air quality issues without the need for machines. And secondly, the thing is, because of all this data science and collection, like what I say, what can we do as a community in a hyper-local context to tackle these issues? So like I said, the project is built on a 2 years initiative where this is the first proof of concept that was done 2 years ago, where it was, I worked with a group of school children in Tower Hamlets in UK, where we used this kind of low-tech wearable devices to kind of get them to go out into the space and perceive the quality of air through this gesture sensing. So put it in a very simple way, if you think the air is good, you raise up your hands. If you think the air is bad, you pinch your nose. The thing with this is that it is about in a sense the data collection, because what we want to do is to it combines wearable tech, which is these tools, and also machine learning algorithm at the back end, where we have been collecting a lot of historical air quality sense data and also non-related air quality data. The questions we have is first two layers of it. The first layer is with all this data out there, the public Internet of Things devices which capture air quality data, can we actually predict on a very hyper-local level what is the air quality on the streets and neighborhood? The second thing is, can we then actually use the perception data, which is captured through this body gesture sensing wearable, to see what's the correlation between how accurate we are in sensing the quality of air versus what the machine is telling us? So if you think, for example, if you think the air is good, you might do this gesture, and when we correlate to the data that's collected in real time as to when you are doing it at that moment, how accurate is that correlation between it? So when we did this this initiative 2 years ago, we got it returns an accuracy of 75%. So that was a very good, interesting, good start. It means that human can be actually as accurate as machine in terms of sensing the quality of air. Moving on from this, so what we want to do is, like I say earlier on, like I said, we have been working within Tower Hamlets Borough for 2 years, and we have worked with a total of 120 people over the past 2 years, local residents, council member, activists, and school children. And in fact, 2 days ago, we actually brought the data to the council in Tower Hamlets and actually showed to the councillor the data finding. And the ambition is really to, in a sense, introduce this nationwide. That brings me to... which also then brings me to the collaboration with HackAir, where it is to introduce it in Europe as well. So just to talk a bit of detail about what the strategy is in terms of the project itself. The project involves a series of workshops with citizens, and it involves this kind of sharing experience of air quality in the neighborhood, and then using this kind of wearable technology to record their perception using this, and in effectively making a public statement about the air quality by going out into the street and performing it. The question, the core of this is also to question whether what is the agency and responsibility as a citizen in terms of doing tackling this kind of issues locally. And the data comes in where it's about getting them to make sense of that relationship between what they are doing with the wearable and also what is the data that's collected, so that there's this understanding of the impact that one can have in terms of perceiving air quality issues. The thing that we are trying to do with the project at the end is really to get the participants to actually follow up with choosing a small action to help tackle air quality issue, and in the sense making that small commitment for changes, for behavior change. So that brings me to the collaboration with HackAir. HackAir is an open technology platform that uses, in a sense, it's citizen sensing, it's getting citizens to actually use a low-tech air quality sensor to collect data and upload it on their platform in the hope that with all this data, we could actually collectively figure out a way to tackle the issues. So with HackAir collaboration, what we wanted to do is to work with the community in Berlin and Oslo to figure out with them what they could do in a hyper-local level. The types of collaboration that we are talking about is the body gesture sensing wearable, which then integrates the air quality sensor that's been used by HackAir. Also, we'll be doing a lot of data collection using the sensor, and also we'll be uploading all the data that's collected during this project up to onto their HackAir platform. That brings me to, because we are still at the very initial phase of the project, so I have just carried out two workshops. Unfortunately, it's not in Europe yet, it's still in UK. So the second workshop was in Macclesfield in UK, where there's an additional element of trying to figure out what is that semantic description of air quality. How can you actually describe the air without the need for any technology? So what we carry out is this kind of very low-tech workshop where it's about getting them to go out into the streets and actually describe to us what that quality of air is. What was interesting was through this workshop itself, we realized that a lot of people have issue describing bad air. For example, if you can see it on top left-hand corner, when it comes to describing good air, it's very easy. You can talk about how pastoral, fresh, green the air is. But when it comes to describing how bad the air is, there's a lot of issue with trying to figure out what's the exact word for it. So oftentimes you tend to think that it could be smoky, it could be filmy, but really going beyond that itself. So that's exactly what we want to work within Pollution Explorer, to kind of figure out what is that vocabulary of description of air which goes beyond good, fair and bad, and then to use wearable in a sense to capture this through gesture and to get people to be more involved in kind of understanding what is that relationship and ultimately to make a change behavior change with the participants that we are working with. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we'll move to the second presentation. The second presentation has two titles. Dirt is not an option, and you'll see that there's an evolution, and it goes to now my daily struggles with a hyperobject. So full program, but we're still also with the outdoor and with the nature. So the artist is Kasia Molga. She's a design fusionist, artist, creative technologist. So she's working really on the interaction with science and technology about the perception of nature, she's working with a GROW observatory, which will be presented by FEMATA. It's a gathering of an impressive number of environmental data around Europe.
Hello. My name's FEMATA Conte. Thanks, Nicolas, for the introduction. I'm right here representing the GROW Consortium, which is hosting Kasia's residency. And the GROW is one of the four Horizon 2020 citizen observatory projects concerned with remote sensing and Earth observation. And the consortium, which has 18 partner organizations, spans soil and satellite scientists, permaculturalists, international institutions and community growing activists. And we have some very large-scale ambitions with the project, and they're in two principal areas. One is to generate significant citizen contribution to the scientific challenge of validating soil moisture mapping data that's gathered by satellites through the use of low-cost soil moisture sensors. And the other is to work with existing and new growers to build communities in real life and online to extend citizen science practices and spread regenerative practices to restore soil, and through those practices generate data for science. So we were interested in hosting a Vertigo residency to apply artistic curiosity, inquiry to science, technology, and data, and then translate data into experiences. Fundamentally, for me, GROW is about creating connections. So I've been supporting Kasia in this residency by making connections between her and the different teams in the project, bringing her into the consortium. So, yes.
And so, yes, my name is Kasia Molga, and I am a design fusionist, and I kind of work on the intersection of art, designs, technology, and science, and I'm interested in probing emerging tech and see how they alter our perception and relation to environment and nature. And in particular, I am interested in environmental data, that is signal from entities which kind of constitute the life on this planet. And I like to hack and appropriating this tech to build new connections and direct our kind of attention from the usual self or human-centered realm to execute this idea of collaboration with nature. And naturally, GROW in that respect was a perfect kind of match for me, and I've been very much interested in soil and GROW practices. To the collaboration, I invited a fellow artist, amazing sound artist, Robin Rimbaud, aka Scanner. And our initial proposal was called Ode from the Dirt. We were interested in using this gigantic amount of data which GROW has access to, that is the data from the satellites and also data from ground sensors, and probably using some kind of a machine learning algorithm to help us create this kind of audiovisual sculptures which would become a beacon of soil conditions from around the area. Very little have I known. Today, however, what I want to talk to you about is not the actual outcome, but the process. So basically, I've been within this residency, I've been working on it for the last 7-8 months, and it's still big time work in progress. And just after the initiation meeting, which we had with Vertigo partners and Grow partners, I started getting all the documentations, and also I started talking to scientists and growers and technologists and project leaders, and I realized that, you know, the initial idea which I have had became pretty much irrelevant. The one important thing, or very interesting thing, was that a lot of people had a problem with the word dirt. And so dirt for me was a slang word, which was kind of a sort of provocation about, you know, how people usually, especially city dwellers, perceive soil. For scientists, however, especially scientists from GROW, dirt means a dead matter, which is unnecessary matter in something which is very living, very vibrant, and very amazing, which is soil. And so I started looking first at, you know, how other people, how we all perceive soil. The first thing you do, you obviously Google soil and see what are the definitions, and they're really beautiful. And then, you know, I started looking at Instagram, for example, and trying to see how people picture soil. And so you get, you know, lots of photos of gardens, of fields, of food. For some reason, 10% of these photos, they are plantation of hemp. Go figure. Mm-hmm. For me, soil is a hyperobject, and it's why in my title there is this kind of daily struggle with hyperobject. So hyperobject is the concept coined by Timothy Morton, which is something so big, it's such a big concept that human brain is not capable to kind of comprehend it at once. And for scientists from GROW, soil is a friend, a living organism, something which can make us and break us, or technology, you know, itself. In GROW, we have access to two type of data. One data is the one which you have to imagine, that terabytes of satellite imagery based on which we can probably assess the moisture of the surface of the planet. And then another set of data is coming from this sensor called Flower Power. GROW has 15,000 of them, and mm-hmm. idea is that they will be distributed across Europe. Mm-hmm. They will be given to different growers so that the growers, they will use it to collect data, upload it to GROW database, and then scientists will use it to validate the satellite data. And I personally am interested what is in between. So what is in between the kind of micro and macro. So when I came to the project, you know, the first thing which I wanted to know is what is this data from the ground, from Flower Power, and I wanted to see whether I can find some correlations or dependencies, and whether I can, you know, see whether there is some kind of narrative which I can, you know, start working with. At the very beginning, the data wasn't even available. But I had some sample data sets, and also I've been working with Thinkful, which is the IoT platform which provided API for data collection for GROW. However, there was no interface to plot the data, so I did something for myself, you know, in order for me to see it. I just wrote a little software to make a graphs. And apparently, I became an alpha user, and now it will be part of the interface which GROW is going to be using to collect the data. The most important thing, however, for GROW is the GROW is not only about the digital data, but most importantly, it is about people. The motto, soil connectivity, means connecting people, communities, with science through citizen observatory concept and extremely important issues of present times. So part of the residency for me was to GROW to one of or two of these GROW places, and recently I've been to Greece. And I met, you know, local growers. I could collect data sets which are not available through digital or any other technology, such as, for example, you know, texture or the reasons why people join the movement, or crops, or the past crops, or how many people can benefit from produce from the certain land. And together, you know, that together with the soil moisture data is kind of building a really amazing picture and amazing story about soil and about land and our attitudes to it. There is also, of course, within all of that, there is supposed to be this kind of innovation part. But, you know, I strongly believe that innovation is not going to happen if we don't make it relevant and if we don't make human connections. So this human connection is extremely important here. And so afterwards, when I came back from Greece, I also realized that the innovation or the new ideas, they will never happen unless, you know, I can destroy my own preconceptions, or I can kind of put myself outside my comfort zone, and that has been happening for the last few months. When I came back from Greece, I kind of realized I've been struggling to make a meaningful connection between technology, you know, the people, and organic, powerful, vibrant matter, you know, which is soil. And I questioned whether data provided in binary way can ever reflect or convey the complexity of the whole huge subject. And here is, you don't have to read it actually, you know, in detail, but it's my last mind map. I did, you know, quite a few of them, trying to kind of get my head around all these subjects, which are, you know, equally important, and I'm very passionate, I feel very passionate about it. And, you know, now I kind of feel I'm going into two very important directions. One is to look at soil as a system or technology on its own, and use and kind of asking a question how to express live physical soil via digital means. So together with Scanner, we revisited our kind of initial idea, and one of the concepts which we are working right now is we are making an online network distributed data manifestation, which will be kind of audiovisual disruptions. It might or might not result in from some sort of machine learning or another algorithm to help us go and, you know, understand this gigantic amount of data. And another thread.
I'm curious about creating a work that's using an immersive use of sound, in using binaural sound particularly. I want an audience to feel as actually they physically have a connection with the soil, and not just through an artistic experience, but through a very immersive, connected experience.
In terms of my added value to grow, I will let Fimata finish off.
So I'll just finish off by saying, like, how we think that Grow might use the outcomes of the residency, the artworks that Kasia is creating. I think there'll be a really powerful engagement tool for bringing people into the expanding community of growers, learning about new sustainable practices and generating data. I think it's a really beautiful way of manifesting a real-time connection, like you said, between the macro and the micro. And I think fundamentally, it'll build an embodied understanding, both digitally and physically, of the vital importance of soil and how it connects us and actually how it sustains all of life on Earth. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So the last group now, we're dealing with a plant sense. Now we started with the air, then we get to the soil, and now we'll grow something. So the plant sense, and here we'll have Phil Ares. He's at the University of Lübeck, but he's involved with many institutions. And he really represents a consortium, which is quite impressive, dealing with architecture, with technology, with mathematics, all kind of thing that you can imagine to think about this type of environment. And then we have also a group of artists, which Maria Castellanos and Alberto Valverde. So you see that we're again dealing with a big part of Europe. I think here what is really interesting is again to see, I mean, this way that we can bring a lot of discipline together in the project, and going with some real artifact, going from the abstract to the very pragmatic stuff. So I think it's Phil who is starting first. So I'll let you explain this quite complex.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Phil Ayres. I'm an architect and a researcher at CETA. That stands for the Center for Information Technology and Architecture. That's a research center that's based within the Danish Royal Academy of Fine Arts. I'm also a principal investigator on the host project called Flora Robotica. And just to give a little bit of foundation and context for Maria and Alberto's residency. So Flora Robotica is a four-year funded project under the EU Horizon 2020. It's a project that gathers a very broad consortium of disciplines, and our objective is to look at how to build tight symbiotic relationships between plants and robots to grow architecture and architectural artifacts and spaces. In terms of the robotics, we're looking at decentralized and distributed paradigms, which is working with self-organization. In terms of some of the technologies we're developing, we're evolving robotic controllers for being able to steer plants towards intended targets. But we also have technologies that are about electrophysiology, so actually taking biopotentials directly from plants and understanding the impacts that the environment is putting onto it. We're also building a lot of artificial scaffolds. And this is really the work that we're doing as architects. We're using scaffolds as a way of hosting the robots and also steering the plant growth. And in this way, it's important for us to be able to have design tools that allow us to understand their mechanical performance, but also as a way to instruct their fabrication, because these are artificial growth objects. So we're looking at methods of fabrication using centralized controllers, and we're also looking at using self-organized principles with swarm of robots as a way of producing braided artifacts. We're coming into the final year of the project, and in that year, we're really looking to try and integrate these different technologies to be able to produce experiential spaces that people can enjoy. And you can see more information about the project at this website. So that gives a little brief context for Maria and Alberto's residency.
Hi, everyone. My name is Maria. I'm an artist, and I work with my partner, Alberto Valverde, who is artist and technologist, is today here with us. We are both based in Spain, and we started to work together 9 years ago because we were both interested in the relationships between humans and machines. During the last years, we have been focused in create wearable interfaces with the aim to research about how we can enhance human capabilities. For example, Environment Rest, a wearable device that allows us to link emotions with environmental data. Or this other work, Symbiotic Interaction, a wearable device that allows us to receive data from the plants thanks to a sensor that we have developed. This sensor can measure electrical oscillations in plants, and we realize that these oscillations depends on the environment and the surrounding of the plant. This is only an example of our artistic work with plants. And the plants and the robots were the main reason that to apply with to work with Flora Robotica team. So our first idea of our work for the Vertigo residency was to create a wearable device able to feel the plants in our own skin with the aim of go forward the communication human plants. Then we traveled to Copenhagen and we spent 3 weeks at CETA with Phil and his team. And we also visited other Flora Robotica partners at AT University. And we also traveled to Lübeck, the University of Lübeck in Germany. So the more we know about Flora Robotica project, the more we think that something more apart the wearable will be needed in our artwork in order to engage the public. So we plan to develop an interactive garden, as you see in the picture, a garden that will be the main brain of the installation. We also plan to develop some mechanical plants
moved by the biological plants. And the key of the artwork, some soft devices able to pick them up by the public and feel the plants on their hands, like this one. Well, back in Spain, we started to work at Laboral Art Center in Gijón, our producer, in the design of all the parts of the garden. We built our electronics, our electronic holders, the interfaces, and the garment, using 3D printing as an useful tool, sorry. And the result is that a big garden that now is displayed at Laboral Centro de Arte until September. An installation that allows the public to know and experiment the secret language of plants. A transdisciplinary work which connects art, science, technology, and society. So let's see a video of the artwork.
Residency actually feed back to the project. And really, I think these two slides allow us to begin to see the linkage. Our vision in 2015 is on the left, where we were beginning to explore the idea that we would be building architectures that have this relationship between artificial growing artifacts, biologically growing artifacts, and this ecology of distributed and decentralized robotics, together with the human factor. So the human would be in the loop here. Now, you may have noticed that in the film that I showed about the project at the outset, we didn't actually show any people in that movie at all. And this is where I think the first contribution comes back from the artist residency, is to remind us that we need to be engaging with the human in the loop. And what's very nice is, of course, Maria and Alberto have actually produced interfaces that allow us to plug directly into some of the architectural material, the plants that we're dealing with. They're also offering a very intimate understanding of what an architecture could be. So here, the interfacing is really about being on the body. And to me, as an architect, this harks back to some of the work from the 1960s, looking at people like Koop Himmelblau, and Hans Rucker, for example, where there was this kind of perhaps more of a scenographic understanding of the relationship between a very intimate architecture and how that mediates between the body and the broader world. We bring this forward 50 years and we see that the technologies now actually exist for us to be actually in some kind of technologically mediated conversation with plants directly. So I think that is the real innovation that this residency has brought to the project. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So just stay on stage. You can come with me if you're. And I will invite also the other just to join me here around. So first, before this thing jump on my face like, you know, the alien stuff, what is making this sound? To what does it react?
No, I don't.
Do you still have your mic?
Yes. Now it's a demo version. The device works with the plants connected with the sensors.
now it's running the sound and the vibrations that you can feel where it's connected to the plant.
So there's somebody who is a plant here making the no symbiotic. Okay, so thank you very much for your presentation. I'll start there. There was one word that came, I think, in your two presentation. It's the hyper something, hyper local, hyper system. If I start the getting really hyper. Perhaps if we get to hyper-local stuff, you know, we speak a lot about the data privacy and things like that. How you see the connection, I mean, the impact on the people? You want to involve more the people, they will be the detectors, but then they might be trapped in pollution, we can track their data, their aggression. How see really the impact of people? Because they will be the sensors, so we can also track them with us. How you see this relation between, again, the data protection, the data that we sense, what would be the impact on this side, do you think?
So, just to clarify as well, regarding the project, the wearable, in a sense, is designed in a way that enables people to actively record their perception. So it's kind of different from a typical wearable that we see that always passively records the biometric data and other data from the user, from the wearer. So this is intentionally designed with the idea that this is not about the technology recording constantly, but it is about when the citizen wants to make a data, wants to actively say something, then they perform that gesture in itself. So through this, they understand that there's that relationship between what they have contributed and what is collected. So that's that clear thing. Just also in terms of the data protection as well. So in the project, it's been made clear from the beginning with the participants that when they take part in this workshop, they will be contributing this type of data. So they are very well aware of what is being collected. But also most importantly is that through this whole process, there was no personal information that's collected from them as well. There's only the perception data that's collected. So I'm not sure whether I answered.
Yeah. No, that's well. You're also dealing with, with subjectivity perception. And then we know, for instance, when we look at security issue, you know, when you, for instance, you put cameras in a place because people are scared, and we see what's the impact on the perception on security when we tell people you'll be safe because they're camera. And the results in large studies that the people who don't really care about the camera, they even care less because they don't believe in the camera. And the one who think that they will be more protected, in fact, as the camera there, it proves that something might happen. Everybody's getting worse with the camera. Yeah. Here with the personal judgment, you might feel the bad smell, but perhaps not the toxic stuff. So how could you have avoided misjudgment or increasing the fear, which has kind of bad impact on politics and that?
I think it's interesting what you say, because from those workshops that I did, I noticed that, I mean, we all noticed when we were doing the workshop that a lot of participants have much more keener sense of the perception of the environment after they come into the workshop. So for example, because what we did was in the workshop, we had this open discussion first about what air quality is, what is the relationship they have with and the issues they have in their neighborhood. And when we introduced them the idea, when they went to the walk, in which they wear the wearable, most of them realized that, I didn't realize that actually I could smell this smoke smell. It's after we talk about this in detail, then we realize you could actually notice all these differences. But this is precisely what we want to kind of capture. Because the thing is, we are so immune to the environment around us. In a sense, we are not very sensitive to what we are capturing, what we are perceiving in the environment. So this is kind of, in a sense, to enhance that kind of perception through this wearable. But in a sense, it's also for them to realize that they could actually be very sensitive in understanding the environment and using it to, in a sense, be more aware of what is around them. Yeah.
So, Femada, when you're working with an artist at Grow, does it also change the perception, or the emotional perception of the scientist when they work. But she's coming, you know, with a side of dirt and thing, in a provocative way for sure. But I mean, this kind of emotional relation with the topic, does it change, you feel, with time?
I think it really does. I mean, Kasia picked up on how dirt actually, you know, feels like almost an offensive word to some of the soil scientists because they have such a deep and personal relationship with the soil. But also, I remember when we were on the bus going to the GROW meeting, so Kasia's come to a couple of consortium meetings that we've had, and talking to some of the scientists who are very, you know, like there's a soil biologist and a soil physicist, and I was like, it's two different kinds of soil science. But saying how you could then use data from soil and then use that to make an artwork, and it was like, really? How? How can you make that happen? How can you make data speak in an artistic way? But it's like, well, actually, yes, if you apply artistic principles and things to things like scientific data, you can make it more alive to much more people. And I think that's one of the things, forgive me if I'm saying it's wrong, but like one of the things that Kasia is hoping to do with her artwork. So I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
No, I'm just nodding.
We saw that you're also influenced by the scientists because they used to take care of big systems, but also put them. So now we see that it's kind of a struggle to say what is the limit of the system? How you? So if somebody else is jumping in a new residency, and we'll have announcement just after. So what would you say to the artists if they might sort of be trapped in the same, you know, tremendously complex system?
I think the most important thing would be don't fear to get scared and overwhelmed and just go for it. I mean, you know, the working with so many, I mean, it is the biggest project. It's like 18, I've been working with 18 scientific institutions, and I think I've spoken to most of the scientists by now. And, you know, each of them, you know, they all work with soil, but each of them comes from slightly different, you know, aspect of soil science and food science. And everyone obviously feels that, you know, his or her, you know, research is the most amazing and important and passionate, and everyone has some kind of agenda for me, you know. So it's been kind of, you know, quite difficult. I had to be very diplomatic in order to kind of say, dude, I am the artist here. No, but it's about, I think, like, the role, you know, I can talk about, you know, for myself, but I think that the role of artist and designer in that respect is to help scientists convey their research, which is very complex, and also, you know, the issue which we are dealing with, you know, in terms of soil and food, possible, you know, future of food in Europe, how it will, you know, how will it will be affected through the climate transition and or migration. There are huge issues, and normally, I mean, you know, people in the cities, we don't really, I mean, I don't give a second thought about it. You know, I go to the grocery store and I get my avocados. But, you know, there is a huge level of awareness which needs to be kind of brought up regarding those issues. And I think my, you know, role of the artist is to show that those complex issues shouldn't be, you know, kind of scared of or avoided to talk or think about.
Usually we say that the artist is bringing the emotional, the cultural, the social part to this kind of hardcore science, strict, rigid, and I'm joking a little bit. but do you have your perception now when you look at the soil, when you go out in the field, having talked to the scientists, and do you also look now at the soil differently? Do you perceive it differently?
In fact, I asked all the growers to send me soil samples. So yeah, the postman at the moment has a very funny job delivering, like, you know, bags of soil to my house. I think I do, because It does change your awareness regarding, for example, what sort of food you're buying, you know, whether the food comes from the local farm, and then you kind of start asking questions, you know, what sort of, you know, practice the farmer, you know, has got there, you know, in order to provide this food. There's another kind of really amazing human aspect which I have learned about, and I think, you know, not many people talk about it, is that farmers outside the cities, there's a prevalent problem of loneliness. People are really lonely, you know, like in Poland, for example, there is even a TV show called Find a Wife for a Farmer.
in France,
you know,
too.
But it's something, you know, it's like, you know, it kind of affects the food supply, you know, whether you want it or not.
We even have this show in Switzerland, and if it's tiny, they feel also lonely. So I go to the architects, because, you know, we usually think about the farms, big lands and thing, but here we saw a smaller garden, and also think about the urban environment, and you know, all this issue of densification of the city and how we can embed, we speak a lot about garden within the city, so there's a change how we can consider with the densification, our very notion to landscape, to nature, to soil. So in your collaboration, you think it's also bring another perspective towards this major issue?
Certainly. I mean, I think, I mean, just to capture some of the discussion that's been going on, you know, the question of habituation has been raised. So that the fact that we can actually become very habituated to our environments. And then the question about the bringing awareness back, I think Florobotica has the potential to be doing this in terms of our particularly urban landscape. So we kind of, in an abstract way, understand that plants are important to homeostasis of our ecology. And yet when we go out into our urban landscapes and we see how we deal with plants, we tend to kind of push them to the boundaries, to the fringes of things. They're used perhaps more in a scenographic way than in a way that might actually provoke a different kind of understanding about their role. And this is what I think is really interesting about Florobotica. It's the way in which we can be building a biohybrid that allows us to perhaps start to functionalize plants in ways that allow us to accumulate material towards architectural objectives. One of the challenges, of course, is that plants start small before they start to get big. And so this is why in the project we're using horticultural devices such as the scaffolds, which kind of come from the idea of the trellis. So the trellis in the garden is a kind of structure that is anticipatory. It suggests where a plant, firstly, it actually offers a mechanical scaffold for a plant. But it also suggests where plants will be going. And so it provides an architectural frame. And so in an urban exterior context, we could begin to imagine that we have these scaffolds that are beginning to train plants that might have an initial role as benches. And then as they mature, they start to transition into having roles for canopies, for example. And then we start to have a situation where we've got a much richer kind of landscape that would start to provoke new understandings about the relationship and the requirement that we need for these organic elements within our urban environments. The really interesting thing, I think, with the work that Maria and Alberto are doing is that it brings that engagement even closer by linking directly to real-time data that a plant is producing. So this was a revelation for me when I started the project. You know, I approached plants with a great ignorance, understanding them in my perception as being incredibly slow responders. They are perhaps, you know, that they can provide a kind of embodied memory, but do so through their morphology or do so through perhaps trauma to their skin. And I had no realization that really they are completely decentralized and self-organizing systems that operate in real time. So by having these, by grabbing this data and beginning to understand that, you have a completely different relationship to the plants. And although I haven't actually experienced their work because it's down in Spain and I didn't have the opportunity to go earlier in the week, our partners have produced some very interesting experiments. We recently had our second review of the project where they had set up a plant which had the electrophysiology and had linked it to a Bayesian network that had allowed the plant to learn to speak. And they invited one of the reviewers to come and touch the plant. So by touching the plant, you actually affect a biopotential. And as the reviewer touched the plant said, "Oh, your hands are cold." And I mean, just that kind of response just puts a completely new frame into a relationship between the person and the plant.
So we'll even put AI, like in the previous project, in the plants and bring a big lighthouse project altogether. However, I see some difference between you and what to know if there's a kind of conceptual battle, because when you create your robot or your artificial structure, it's kind of like a plant-like a material and how it's grown, how it's, and when you do your artifacts, it's more done, you know, very clearly with electronics. It's even transparent. You state really clearly what is electronic, what is plant. Can you explain why you make very clearly this difference?
We use in our artwork these mechanical plants and these electronics is moved by the plants. The plants is the brain of the garden, and our plants move these electronic devices.
So you want really clearly to state the difference between the not make something which is blurry between the two.
Yeah.
So
Maybe I could just offer a little perspective. I mean, if you take the view of the whole, then you could understand that as an entity, and it's comprising a number of discrete elements, but nevertheless it's still an ecology. So despite the fact that they might be kind of separated elements and you can clearly identify the organic from the artificial, in terms of their interaction, they might start to affect each other in symbiotic ways. And that's where the association back to our project really is very strong. Because although we're dealing with both organic and artificial elements, the idea is that in concert they are producing a superorganism that is a biohybrid.
So I'll move toward the audience. Are there any questions?
Hi, thank you very much, all of you. My name is Larissa. I don't have a question, I have a suggestion, because I think I see something happening here that nobody mentioned, is about the fact that plants produce oxygen, you see, which is very useful for air pollution business over there, which is then related to the soil pollution. So you all together should start a consortium, I think.
It actually crossed my mind when I was.
It's what I said just before, but and involving the artificial intelligence too. So, because so for Ralf Dom, he's here, he's one of the instigators of the STARTS project, will be a nightmare. Everybody coming with a big lighthouse, grading anything. Another question?
My question is that you see, the soils seem to be south of Spain. And Portugal and all this you travel to, I'm talking about for you in the middle. Who from Portugal?
Me, Spain.
Yeah, Spain and Portugal, and then Denmark, Copenhagen, and Lübeck, Germany. What about south and north? Is any way that the same pollution that the, you know, the same soils you had, that will prevail the soils?
Yeah, other region, I think it's...
Yeah.
Because here we're redealing, for sure it's a European project, but I think it would be interesting how, because I mean, the Earth is just one place, we cannot stick to the frontiers.
I think that in general, you know, the idea is to expand outside the Europe, but at the moment we are limited to the European zone because of the data and the funding, yeah. I suppose.
Kasia mentioned in her presentation about the grey places, which is where we are distributing the sensors. And so there are 9 grey places across Europe, unfortunately not wider than that. And what we've done as a project is to try and make sure that those grey places are in as a wider spread of climactic zones as possible. So there's one in Greece, and then there's one in the Netherlands, there's Spain, and so we spread it all about. So we're learning about soil in different areas, so it's it's not all one kind of soil in one place, but it's spread. But yeah, hope that helps.
Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Another last question. If it's not the case, I will conclude our session by asking you if you have a dream in 3 to 5 years, what could be the impact? You know, here we are a small room of people, knowledgeable, interested. You're also your own group of activists, but they're already convinced people. So how do you think you could, if you could dream about what impact on your work, all of you, in 5 years, what would be your dream?
We have a clear goal. The idea is that through doing all this work, we really want to ultimately have a way to measurably improve air quality. I think that's the thing that is missing at the moment, the linkage between all the data collection on air quality. There's no link between how citizens could affect a change. And because air quality issue is such a long-term thing, you don't actually feel it now. Whatever you're doing, you don't actually seem to see an impact visibly. So how do you actually link that connection and enable the government, the local council, and the citizen to understand that what they are doing in their everyday life could have an impact? So that's exactly what we're trying to do. Hopefully the aim is, what we have is hopefully we can do it in Europe with Hack Air. The other thing is also to work locally in Tower Hamlets, where we have been based in, to kind of work with everyone in the borough to kind of work collectively to figure out this question. Yep.
For the Grow Observatory, just this one project that we're involved in, the ambition is to become self-sustaining beyond the life of the funding from the European Commission. So one of the work packages that we're involved in the project is how do we become self-sustaining as a citizen observatory? How do we make the idea of participating in citizen observation in earth science appealing so that we continue to build a community beyond that? So that's one of the things that we're working on now as part of the project.
I guess for me, the GROW project is about tackling problem of soil depletion. Soil are depleting because of certain behaviors and habits which we have. And so I suppose for me it would be good to see, how we can first of all be a bit more thoughtful or ethical in terms of getting our food, and also stop looking at environment as the resource. Maybe not looking at soil and technology as the way of intensification of its capacity, but as a partner, and just change the attitude to it, I suppose.
Okay, maybe for me, 5 years is. The aim is continue research, thinking about the future through the art. Imagine new futures in which we can enhance human capabilities through other beings.
And bring other music.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to build off your point about the project continuing. So you're describing about trying to develop mechanisms for self-sustainability. But I would like to see in 5 years the EU having mechanisms to actually fund promising research that has been invested in right from the outset. So in terms of Flora Botica, it's a ground research project. And of course, we end up in a project that has more questions than we started with. And it has great promise in many different avenues. And it would be really nice that there might be mechanisms that allow us to actually continue without getting to a point where we say, well, that's the end, and we lose the impetus.
I think that's the dream of every scientist, I think. Okay, thank you very much. Applause for our contribution.